Recently I've seen a lot of people playing with these things. For some reason they suddenly became so dirt cheap that even elementary school students can afford them. For example, I got this one for free, as a replacement for the one with a broken fiber, which only cost me about $55 with shipping included. In my opinion, they should never be that cheap, and honestly they should be banned because most people are dumb, and dumb people plus this thing equals danger. If you ever even think about buying one, make sure you get purple goggles. Cheap shiny scrap isn't gonna protect your precious eyes from this monster. Is that supposed to be enough? How the hell packages fragile things like that? Only buy goggles from trusted manufacturers, such as... They're definitely quite expensive, but you can't buy a new pair of eyes. Always check whether the optical density at the desired wavelength matches your laser maximum power output. You might wonder, where can I even get them, if no one ships to my country? Well, camera equipped VR goggles may be considered a substitute in cases where real laser goggles are absolutely unavailable. But they do have one serious drawback: if they break for any reason, you won't be able to see anything at all. So, if you're gonna go down the slippery route, make sure a kill switch is always within easy reach. Never look into the beam, even while wearing goggles. They may not be designed to protect from direct light. Why is this so important? Well, because even the crappiest diode laser with large beam divergence still produces highly chromated light. In terms of power density, looking at 10 milliwatts laser dot can be more dangerous than staring at the sun. Even a small portion of that beam is enough to permanently damage your eye, since your eye contains a lens that focuses light on a tiny dot on your retina. If you don't believe me or the thousands of safety manuals out there, just check out this beautiful article, where they literally shine different lasers into monkeys' eyes to find out how much damage they will cause. Funny, isn't it? Yet, I've seen one so-called professor claim that he's never worn goggles in over 10 years of working with high-powered femtosecond lasers. Like, this is fine. Be aware that those b**** exist, and they are dangerous. Use your common sense. Always wear goggles, and never look into the beam with your remaining pair of eyes. Your brain tends to fill in missing details with surrounding pixels, so you might not even notice something went wrong until it's too late. There have been real cases where people went permanently blind in both eyes from just looking at the beam with one. It's so fun in games until someone loses an eye. Also, make sure that everything is securely fastened and no one enters the room while the laser is powered on. What did I say about the diode? To be more precise, it's not just a single diode. The one I've got has 9 of them, the other might have different numbers, and therefore a different impedance. Here's a table I found that seems pretty accurate. While it outputs 130 watts of optical power, it does require a current of 16 amps at 15 volts, consuming 240 watts of electrical power. Quite a lot, I'd say. You also shouldn't exceed a temperature of 45°C, otherwise the diodes will die from diffusion. Optical power drops significantly as the temperature rises, so active cooling is essential. To increase the lifetime and get more stable results, temperature stabilization is needed as well. I used 2 thermal electrical coolers rated at 70 watts each. While it wasn't quite enough, I didn't run the laser at full power. The reason these models are sold so cheaply is because they lost optical power to the point that they can no longer reach the laser threshold of the fiber they're designed to pump. That's why I thought that deriding, i.e. driving them with lower current, was necessary. Besides, I didn't have a powerful enough power supply, so this was the only option. To control the TICs, I've just used a simple PID loop with a set point of 20°C and one MOSFET that was driven with a 100 kHz PWM signal. I guess TICs won't see any difference with constant current. Just be aware they don't like cycling. One can use a full bridge to use both heating and cooling function. Me thinks it's just redundant and too complex. Driver? What did I say about the driver? Well, there are a lot of ways to drive laser diode. Just remember that any diode is a current device that will readily consume as much current as you're gonna provide. So using the constant current driver is really important if you don't want to kill them. No, your constant current lab supply isn't gonna work, because I'm 100% sure it has a lot of capacitance on its output. So when the diode suddenly changes its resistance, and it will, for example, from receiving the reflected light when you decide to cut some metal, it will consume all of the current that is available, and probably die, fortunately. I've made a simple current mode bug driver, because it's pretty much the only converter topology that is able to provide continuous current. I mean, the boost isn't suitable. One can use a linear stabilizer and drive it with voltage near the targets, but that's... Honestly, I wouldn't recommend using the UC3843, because it sometimes acts weird, has quite low range, and so on. Maybe I'm just too stupid, but here is what I've used, if you're somehow interested. Notice, however, the output capacitance shouldn't exceed 100 nF, but lack of capacitance isn't desirable as well, because it protects from voltage spikes like from ASD and makes the circuit more stable. So, what is it capable of? Let's start with the damaged one. As you can see, when I shine the laser into the output side, it also shines here, while it shouldn't. That means the fiber is broken, and as I start increasing power, all the light comes out of the spot. For some reason, it doesn't even feel hot until it does this. Without the lens, the output from fire looks like an intense flashlight, and you can really feel the heat, but it's hard to make it burn things. Imagine you're using goggles when it looks that bright on camera, though. Removing the rest of the fiber with my paws only took me 2 days, because of the ceramic shell. By the way, don't even open the case unless you really need to, because even the smallest amount of dust will explode on the diode's edge, and it will be permanently damaged. Doing this in the bathroom might be a better option, but be aware. Here I actually did a quite stupid thing by removing the output lens. Don't even ask why. But now the whole thing's ruined. I was able to focus it back into the spot of very low quality though. Anyways, in real life this really looks scary, because you really can't see where the spot is, until it's too late. Now, let's install the lens on the other module and check it. With input power on 150 watts, it's able to make the steel blade spark, but don't put it too close to the lens, otherwise it does this. While the thing is dangerous, it isn't really useful. You can't focus the beam in the spot smaller than the fiber size, and even then, it's not really useful, because the output isn't a collimated beam anymore, it will diverge anyway. That essentially means you can't really use it in machines like a CNC, or make a decent graver out of it. The wavelength of 150 nanometers is really far away from commonly available YAG and D absorption lines, so you can't really use it as a pumping source either. In place, welding or cutting seems like the only real usage, but it does require more modules, because 130 watts clearly isn't enough. Besides, out of the box, nothing protects the laser from getting its own beam back. Pumping the laser fiber seems to be the only suitable usage, but where are you gonna get one?